We'll continue with the Slido questions for this session, so please get out your smartphones. Welcome back. We're delighted to begin our afternoon programming. To introduce our guest speakers this afternoon, I'm delighted to introduce Brett House, the Deputy Chief Economist with Scotiabank. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the kind introduction for the introduction. Not to be too meta, but it really is a great privilege for me to be here today on behalf of Scotia to both welcome you and to introduce this conversation as a sponsor of the Public Policy Forum's Growth Summit. And more personally, as a trade economist, it's a particular delight for me to introduce what I know will be a very insightful and lively discussion between Canada's Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Honourable Chrystia Freeland, and Elena Cherney, the Wall Street Journal's Canada Bureau Chief. As Deputy Chief Economist at Scotiabank, but also again personally, as a fellow 40-something and a member of Gen X, it's a real pleasure to see Canada's first Generation X-led government, and Mr. Freeland particularly, leading on the international stage with renewed commitment to Canada's core values of openness, flexibility, engagement, inclusiveness, and collective responsibility for the common good. Mr. Freeland, and it's a pleasure to call you that, I applaud the work you and your government are doing to show that Canada truly is at home in the world, as Jennifer Welsh's book noted a few years ago, that we are a nation committed to supporting economic growth and a country open and enduringly open to investment, people, and ideas. As Canada's most international bank, and this is where I pivot to my corporate hat, with operations in some 50 countries, Scotiabank sees firsthand the benefits of highly integrated markets, building relationships that enable the movement of goods, services, and people around the world is critically important for Canada. We know that this is especially true within North America, where over the past 23 years, trade between Canada, the US, and Mexico has more than tripled under the North American Free Trade Agreement. This is why a major part of Scotiabank Economics research agenda is focused on telling the success story of NAFTA. And so I'm grateful for this opportunity to hear from you, our partners in government, and to engage with you in a constructive dialogue on Canada's economic future. It's this kind of open conversation that fosters the creative thinking that we need in order to make the investments for Canada's long-term economic well-being. And so we're truly fortunate to have with us today two people who understand that winning in the US-Canada relationship isn't a zero-sum game. Enhancing and modernizing our interaction with our closest neighbor and our most important trading partner really is a win-win proposition. So welcome, Mr. Freeland and Ms. Cherney. I look forward to your discussion.
Okay. It's going to be a bit perilous for us here.
Wait a second. Nobody
told
us
about really,
this is like the wrong chairs.
They're not really designed for ladies. Eddie, next time, you know, like the dresses, the stools.
Okay, so that aside, let's jump right in. We have a running clock. It is, I believe, day 90, almost 100 days into the Trump administration, and we've seen a number of shifts on a number of issues, including trade and trade with Canada. So from sort of wholesale renegotiation of NAFTA, there was a move toward talk of tweaking the relationship. And now this week, a little bit of tougher talk on Buy American and Hire American and Canada's dairy industry. So what do you expect? What does this administration, what does the US administration want from Canada, want to change on trade?
Okay, so let me start by saying it's great to be here with you, Elena.
C'est un très grand plaisir pour moi d'être ici avec vous aujourd'hui. Comme vous savez, nos relations avec les États-Unis sont très importantes pour le Canada. Je crois que c'est l'enjeu, le défi le plus important pour notre gouvernement, pour moi personnellement.
And it's especially a pleasure for me to be here with Elena and also with Eddie. It's like old home week for us because we were all at the Globe and Mail. And I will say one thing that I think Elena and Eddie will especially find funny to begin with. I was with the Prime Minister, actually, in the United States. We came out of a meeting, and I turned to him and I said, oh my God, that is such a great scoop. No one knows that. And he looked at me and he said, "You're not a journalist anymore. It's not a scoop. People do tell you things they don't tell other people." So, you know, that journalist thinking is still there.
Okay, so tell us.
I won't tell you that scoop.
No. Okay, but tell us,
but give
on,
us
the
a relationship.
Scoop on the relationship.
Yeah, so yeah. On the relationship, look, you said, Elena, I think, you know, part of that question was, what do you expect? And I think it would be fair to say we are in a time in general and with the US administration where every day is a new and interesting day. And that's a great time for journalists. Broadly though, I feel very good about the relationship that we, our country, has been developing with the United States. We looked at the numbers ahead of this meeting, and by our count, since this new government was formed, we've had more than 80 visits to the United States at all levels of government, more than 180 meetings, including 10 different cabinet secretaries and obviously the president. So we have been developing across the whole of government. I do want to really say also, give a lot of credit to the opposition, especially Rona Ambrose, but both the Conservatives have been very supportive, NDP as well. We've had all party groups of MPs traveling to the United States. The provinces and premiers from all parties have been very involved and very supportive. And also another thing, because this is sort of a public policy, but also businessy gathering, something that has actually been quite heartwarming for me is I have felt personally tremendous support from Canadians, from Canadian business, from Canadian labor, from Canadian civil society in building this US relationship. The CEO of one of the Canadian banks, when I talked to him about the relationship and sort of said, you know, what connections do you have we can draw on? And he said, "Minister, the entire resources of this bank are at the disposal of the government of Canada." It was actually really touching. And I do feel our country right now, I see Mayor Nenshi is here, so I should mention also the mayors. I feel our country really gets that this is a critical moment. It's a new US administration with some openly protectionist views. And I do feel we have sort of a strong Team Canada approach, and I think that is serving us well. I also feel like the main pitch that we're making is to really point, you know, I think we're mostly Canadians here, so it's not going to be a surprise to anyone for me to say, look, the reality is we Canadians spend a lot more time thinking about the Americans than they do about us. And with every new administration, it's helpful to remind them of the importance and quality of the U.S.-Canada economic relationship, that this is a balanced, mutually beneficial relationship. In fact, and this is a surprise when we say this to our American partners, we are the single biggest export market for the United States, twice as large as China. That means that it's a good relationship and it's important for them. And I do feel, you know, notwithstanding some of the rhetoric that people occasionally hear, I do really feel we've developed very good lines of communication. And I'm confident, you know, so far so good. And I feel that we're in a good place and we're gonna continue to be.
So that all makes sense, and I'd love to know which bank CEO that was. That's interesting. Despite that, there are some sticking points, very clear sticking points, and I'd be interested to know what you can do about some of these things. I mean, the other day in Wisconsin, which apparently is home to a million dairy cows, Trump said, quote, "In Canada, some very unfair things have happened to our dairy farmers." And that's very much at odds with the view, I think, here of the supply management system. I think Prime Minister Trudeau spoke this morning about supply management, said it's working well, and that he will lay out the facts. How do you reconcile a much more protectionist US view with very long-held Canadian practices, and generally speaking, a very free flow over the border? How do you get past a very different point of view on this?
Well, since you've raised dairy, let me say on dairy specifically, Ambassador McNaughton wrote a very good letter. I think it was published yesterday or the day before, in response to those comments, which just laid out the facts, and let me repeat them. The fact is, U.S. dairy exports to Canada in 2016 compared to 2015 are up 16%. Canada is the second largest market for U.S. dairy exports, second only to Mexico. Our dairy market is, in fact, more open to imports than the U.S. market is. And when it comes to trade on dairy, and in fact, in other areas too, but on dairy in particular, we are fully compliant with all of our NAFTA and WTO commitments. So I understand that Wisconsin dairy farmers are unhappy. I actually talk to unhappy farmers all the time. One of them is my dad, although he's not a dairy farmer. And it's the job of politicians to respond to the unhappiness of some of their constituents. But on dairy, we are very comfortable with our position. And I think that, you know, trade lawyers will agree with us.
But I guess one of the issues is it's not clear that this administration is looking at some of those facts, like compliance or the WTO, that Trump is, you know, necessarily familiar with all of the nuances there when he comes out and says that Canada is not compliant. How do you figure out, even in this kind of administration, where there are obviously some departures from traditional U.S. administrations, who to talk to and how? Who are you? I'd be really interested to get some insight. I'm sure lots of people would. How do you and your cabinet colleagues figure out who has power in the Trump White House, in the cabinet, how you should be talking to them, who to talk to on a daily basis? How do you track that?
You know, I think that that's something that the Prime Minister was very focused on, even actually before the election. And, you know, we were very careful and thoughtful about not making pronouncements about the US election. That was their decision. It wasn't our race. And we were very energetic, you know, from the day after the election about building contacts with the new administration at all levels. I felt a little bit sorry for some of the new cabinet secretaries. Like, the minute they were named, we sort of found anyone in Canada who had any connections with them and started working that network. And I feel at this point, our government has very strong lines of communication into all the key people in the White House. I would say, you know, we have at a whole of government level several times a day contact with people in the White House. And at the ministerial level, my colleagues and I feel we've really developed very strong working relationships with our counterparts. You know, for me, that's Wilbur Ross, the Commerce Secretary, and Rex Tillerson, the Secretary of State. I talk to them and see them often. I think that you've heard from Bill Morneau earlier today. I think Bill has been developing a really good relationship with Steve Mnuchin. I sat next to Steve at a lunch and he was telling me how nice Bill is, so that's good. I told him I agree. And, you know, so I do really feel at that working level, we have those personal relationships across government. And again, I do want to say, of course, it's at the federal level, but the provinces have been extremely active, and the opposition parties have been too.
Can you talk a little bit more about Rex Tillerson and your relationship with him? What's your impression? And obviously, Canada has stood behind the U.S. in its recent action in Syria. How have you found working with him, and what is your impression?
So I most recently saw Rex last week for a couple of days. We had the G7 foreign ministers meeting. And that turned out to be a particularly important meeting because of the timing. It happened, the US strike in Syria had been late on the Thursday night, and the foreign ministers meeting was on the Monday and Tuesday. And then Secretary Tillerson that Tuesday night flew to Moscow. So it was in the middle of a lot of events. I think that it was a very effective and useful meeting. Secretary Tillerson had at that meeting, and the G7 foreign ministers meeting, it was my first one, so I don't know if this is characteristic or not, but people tell me it sort of is. It's quite an intimate kind of meeting. You have only ministers sitting at the table. So it's eight people sitting at the table because Federica Mogherini was there as the high representative of the EU as well. So it's a small table, you know, smaller than a lot of the groups here. each minister has just one official in the room. So you have a real sense that it's a real conversation. And I think for Rex, it was an important meeting because the United States had just taken this strong action. Everyone around that table, each country had supported the United States. And what we felt in that meeting was the most important public message we wanted to send was for Secretary Tillerson to travel to Moscow, in particular to try to apply some pressure on Russia in its behavior in Syria. And we wanted him to go there feeling he was speaking for the G7 and knowing that, having that collective mandate. And I think he did go to Moscow with that collective mandate. And I think he really felt strengthened by that, which was the intention.
Do you think that that message will be heard in Moscow? Do you think there's any chance that Putin will stop backing Assad and, as you said earlier this month, be on the right side of history when it comes to Syria?
You know, I think, you know, what Secretary Tillerson said ahead of the meeting, he obviously has a lot of experience in dealing with Russia, and I think that's a big advantage. What he said ahead of that meeting is he said, look, I don't expect the Russians to change their mind and certainly not to change their public position after one conversation with me. And I think that's very right and sober and practical. But I do think, particularly on Syria, I think the chemical weapons attack can represent for Russia a turning point and, frankly, an opportunity to get out of a not great situation. You know, Assad is not the greatest ally to have. Do you really want to be on that side of things? And there is an opportunity for Russia, which I really hope that Putin will take, to join with the Western countries and also a lot of the Arab countries in pushing for a truly negotiated solution in Syria, in ending what is the greatest humanitarian crisis of our time. You know, it's a true bloodbath. And Russia can, if it chooses, be part of the solution. You know, talks, negotiations in Geneva with Stéphane de Mistura, the UN envoy, have been happening. But the reality is the Assad regime has not been serious about those talks. There's an opportunity for Russia to put some pressure on the Assad regime and to say, you know, enough is enough, enough people have died, now is the time to really negotiate a peaceful settlement. And yes, I do think that's possible. I think that would be the best outcome for Syrians, and I think it would be the best outcome for Russia too.
What would the role of what could the role be for Canada in that negotiation and helping Russia to see that potential evolution of its position? What could your role be?
Canada is playing the week before. So last week was the G7 meeting, and the week before that, the EU had convened a Syria meeting in Brussels the Wednesday before. And so I had a chance to spend some time with Stéphane de Mistura, who is leading the UN talks, and also with the Lebanese prime minister, the Jordanian planning minister. And then I spoke in Italy with leaders from the United Arab Emirates as well. So I've had sort of a good sense of people in the region. And I spoke with the Iraqi prime minister a couple of weeks before that. You know, I think as Canadians, one of our national virtues is humility, and I like that about us as a country, but we can take it a little bit too far. And I think we sometimes don't appreciate the extent to which, particularly right now, there is a real demand, and demand in the sort of supply and demand sense of the word, for a strong Canadian voice in the world. There really is. People are very interested. You know, the Jordanians, for example, said to me, I said, you know, what can we do? And they said, we just want there to be more countries like Canada. You guys are actually sending planes to our country and bringing refugees to Canada, and they're becoming Canadian. That is such a great example. That's such a great thing you're doing. So I'll go 30,000 feet then a little bit more on Syria. On this point about there being a real demand for the Canadian voice, this is such an important moment in international relations. I think this is the most volatile moment since the end of the Second World War. After the Second World War, there was this moment when, you know, we all sort of recoiled in horror and said, things can't continue this way. We need to set up some international institutions and international rule of law. This has not been, you know, the two world wars and the Great Depression have not been a great way to run the world. And we set up the Bretton Woods institutions. Canada was a very important voice in creating those institutions. And it's worked pretty well, right? That period since the end of the Second World War has been a time of increasing global prosperity. Right now, those post-Bretton Woods institutions are under tremendous strain. They're under strain partly because of the rise of Asia, and they need to accommodate other countries. They're under strain partly because of pressures in the Western world, where we're seeing in a lot of countries a sort of protectionist, nationalist mood that's saying, well, is this global order working for us? And so I think there is a real need to remake some of those institutions. And I think we as Canadians should not underestimate the extent to which there is a real desire around the world for the Canadian voice there. And when it comes to Syria, you know, what I have heard from neighboring countries, very much from Stéphane de Mistura, is that Canada has tremendous credibility. The fact that we were not part of the war in Iraq is significant. The fact that we have taken such a big step in welcoming Syrian refugees to our country, and people recognize, you know, that we're not in the position of Europe. These are not people who are just showing up at our doorstep. We're actually going out and saying, we think this is a global crisis. This is not a European crisis or a Middle Eastern crisis, and we're doing our part. And also, you know, thirdly, Elena, the fact that as a country, we are saying that we stand up for Muslims. We stand up for Muslim Canadians. We do not, yeah, it's very important. And I make that point at the anti-Daesh coalition meetings and the Syria meetings that we are not discriminating against Muslim, you know, refugees are welcome in Canada very much, including Muslims. So all of these things, plus our real credibility in the humanitarian space, mean there is definitely a role for Canada in Syria, for sure, and in Iraq.
How loudly can Canada say, I mean, I think it's good to hear you say to stand up for what you believe as a Canadian and what the Canadian position is on refugees and on acceptance of all kinds of people. How loudly can you say that as foreign minister? How loudly can the prime minister say that standing next to Donald Trump, whose views maybe are very different? Does that represent a challenge politically when you're also trying to figure out the dairy relationship and the rest of the NAFTA relationship?
No. I mean, the Prime Minister in the White House was very clear on talking about, proudly, our policy on refugees and immigration. We are always going to stand up for our values, and we're going to be proud of those values. And those values also, by the way, include supporting women's reproductive rights as part of our development program. That's something that I believe in so strongly. And that's something that our government, you know, is putting our money behind as well. And I, you know, look, we have a great relationship with the United States. It is, the economic relationship is balanced and mutually beneficial. We are great allies internationally, and Secretary Tillerson, and also actually Secretary Ross, told me how grateful they were for our full support, and those were the words the Prime Minister used for those strikes in Syria, which I think were absolutely the right thing to do. But that doesn't mean we have to be in lockstep with any other country when it comes to our policies at home. And I don't think anyone expects that. And I certainly know Canadians expect our government to stand up for our values. And that's something I will never not do.
But do the trade tensions at all make it more difficult to sort of hew a slightly separate line on geopolitical issues? For example, if the U.S. were to soften sanctions or lift sanctions on Russia, would that be something Canada would follow suit on? How would you handle such a move?
So first of all, I never answer hypothetical
questions. I knew
questions.
You were going to say that.
I asked that badly.
Can I take it back and find another way to...
I think that's a very, it's a very, very bad foreign policy practice.
Fair enough.
Second of all, on the Russia sanctions, those were discussed by the foreign ministers in Lucca, and there was very strong support by all the ministers around the table for maintaining those sanctions. And the sanctions, just to remind people, are based on some very specific things. They are based on Russia's invasion of Crimea and annexation of Crimea and on Russia's actions in the Donbas. And you know that foreign ministers meeting in Lucca happened the day after the Vimy commemorations. And especially the European ministers, but also Secretary Tillerson, were very aware of that. And there was a lot of discussion around the table about how important for Europe's post-war peace the sanctity of European borders was. And the very grave threat that Russia's violation of European borders in Ukraine posed. So there was real clarity that cannot be accepted because that just poses too dangerous a precedent. So on that specific point, there is clarity and unity in the G7, and our statement reflected that. In terms of how the trade relationship affects the rest of our policy, as I said, and this is one of my phrases that I use a lot in the House of Commons, and I repeat it because it's true. I feel at heart my job consists in doing two things: fiercely defending our national interest, particularly our national economic interest, and I will do that with heart and nerve and sinew. I'm very committed to that, and I'm committed to the Canadian jobs, and at the same time standing up for our values. And I really think it's possible to do both. I think there is not a contradiction there. And I think people respect us more when we stand up for our values.
You and I talked the other day, and we're going to take one or two quick questions from the audience very quick, but I want to ask you one last thing. We talked about how need to react to a very different U.S. administration is a reminder of how very dependent Canada remains on its U.S. partner, and how there's always, for decades, there have been efforts to diversify and to move beyond. You're inheriting a huge challenge. What can you do that others haven't been able to do to try and find us more ways of trading beyond the U.S.?
Well, I think, as people may know, I was trade minister before I was foreign minister. And probably the biggest thing that our government did on the trade side while I was trade minister was CETA, our trade agreement with Europe. That is a huge thing. That is a trade agreement in many ways deeper than NAFTA, particularly when it comes to government procurement. CETA pretty much opens up European government procurement to Canadian companies. That's a market of 500 million people. That's a lot. I think that it is really significant, and it was a bipartisan achievement. So I do want to, acknowledge the work the Conservative government did, especially Stephen Harper and Ed Fast, in getting it to a place that we could get it across the finish line. But it's a big deal that we actually got a huge trade deal done in 2016, 2017, probably the period of the greatest protectionist sentiment in the West since the 1930s. And that is, CETA represents tremendous trade diversification opportunities for Canada. And to all the business people who are here, please take advantage of them. CETA has now been ratified by the European Parliament. That means that as soon as Canada finishes its ratification procedures, and it has now been passed third reading in the House, it's just with the Senate. So if there are any senators here, come on guys, please get CETA done. We need to get the economic benefit. And let's take advantage of this. And then the other opportunity that is a very big one, I would say two more opportunities. Brett is here, and I think there's a Scotiabank presence. I think there are a lot of opportunities in Latin America right now. That's a part of the world that has, they've tried protectionism, and they've realized it doesn't really work. And Canada has some strong historic ties there, so I think there are real opportunities to expand there. And of course, there are lots of opportunities for us in Asia. So yeah, I totally agree with the premise of your question, Elena. I think we do need to work harder than ever to diversify our trade. And we, as a government, you know, we can't actually do it. We don't actually do business. We can create the tools for Canadians. So please go out and take advantage.
Do we have time for one or maybe two? One? We have time for one.
And then can you close your eyes as we get off these stools? I'm not quite sure how we're going
to
do it.
Am I supposed to read that question? I don't, oh, look, it's down there. Okay, that's good. So here's the question. Let me see. Okay, we sort of did that one. Actually, this is a good one. Minister Freeland, on Brexit, how will that affect Canadian trade with the UK? You just started answering this, but this is good. So it's sort of like part two of what
Brexit,
you just said.
I could do the China one too if you want.
Okay, can you do them both in 3 minutes?
Yeah, I'll try.
All right, so Brexit first, then China.
Okay, so there's a Brexit one and there's a China one.
Yeah.
So on Brexit, I have been spending a lot of time working both with Boris Johnson and with Liam Fox. Our relationship with Britain is a very, very strong relationship. I think it's very important to Canada. You know, speaking for myself, my father was born in Britain, my husband was born in Britain, and one of my three kids was born in Britain. And I'll bet you lots of people in this room have strong personal connections with Great Britain too. And they're very keen to have a strong relationship with us. CETA, actually, Britain is still part of the EU. CETA, that's part of the reason I want it to enter into force as quickly as possible. That will be a great deepening of our trade relationship with Britain as well. And I am absolutely confident that CETA will be the floor for our relationship of a post-EU Britain. And there is a very strong commitment by the British for the same. After a trip to Britain last summer, I got a very nice letter from a British baker who said he really wanted trade to be strengthened between Canada and Britain because he remembered baking with red, hard spring wheat flour, which is by far the best. And he's right. It has the highest protein content of any flour in the world. And then there are some questions about China, and in particular one that I want to answer because I think this hasn't been... Dear journalist friends, it hasn't been covered enough.
Okay.
Which Especially is, there was a question about China and Syria. And there was a very interesting moment last week, which was that UN, the UN resolution, which Russia vetoed on Syria, China did not veto it. Both China and Kazakhstan, very interestingly, abstained. That is a significant shift. Traditionally, China has joined Russia in its vetoes. And when the Prime Minister spoke with Premier Li earlier this week, he thanked him for that. I think that was a very constructive move by China. I spoke the week before last with the Chinese envoy to this Geneva process on Syria. And he talked with me about how he appreciated the Canadian position and they wanted to be constructive. And I believe that the meeting between President Trump and President Xi went really well. So I think that there are some real opportunities right now for, you know, I would say the West generally to be developing a stronger, more constructive relationship with China. And, you know, going back to that sort of the post-Bretton Woods or the next Bretton Woods, part of the challenge is going to be bringing China into that international order. And I think that Canada has a real role to play there.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Eddie's going to come help us down from our chairs.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, I know you're both anxious to get off those chairs, but if you just hang on for 1 second, keep your balance for 1 second longer, that would that would be great. You know, Minister Freeland noted at the beginning that that she, Chrystia, Elena, and I all worked at the Globe and Mail at different points. And first off, I'd like to say to your point about the scoop at the White House, I don't need those scoops anymore, but I hope that you're saving them for your memoirs. And I note always in my experience, and more so I think in your experience, that you can take the person out of journalism, but you can never take the journalist out of the person. So it's a kind of way of thinking, looking at the world that never disappears, and I think serves you very well, and I think served you very well here. As a storyteller, because you're a great storyteller, and I think you're telling Canada's story very well. Chrystia and I first met when the Cold War was ending in Kiev, and we were together during the coverage of 9/11. Ellen and I were together during the coverage of the financial crisis, and I think we're living with those things today. Those are the consequences of today. We're seeing the consequences of those historical forces playing out. I think it's very interesting to think of the post-Bretton Woods world as you've described it, and to remember, and thank you for reminding us, that humility is not the opposite of ambition. And Canada is humble.
I'm going to use that line.
And
I'll quote Eddie.
With attribution, of course, because of your journalistic training.
Yes, footnote.
And you know, there's an opening for Canada always because of its humility and because of its place in the world. And there's a necessity for Canada to work hard at there being great international institutions. And I'm glad that you're going to take that on. And I think we all want to hear more of that as we go along. So thank you for that. I want to thank both of you. I also want to thank Scotiabank as our sponsor for this session. And now I will liberate you from your high chairs, and we can go. Thank you.
Okay, to help us down.
Okay, so now we turn to another subject, but they're all knitted together one way or another. And that's the relationship between an interplay between population and prosperity, which is one way or another arisen as a subject on a few occasions today. There's a lot of questions of what size Canada needs. What is an optimum size for Canada? How do we achieve that size? How do we get the labor market participation that that will allow us to continue to prosper, particularly with an aging population? There's many sides to this question, and I would like to welcome to the stage our moderator for this session, who is Marta Morgan, Canada's Deputy Minister of Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship. That is Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship Canada now, IRCC, as everything has an acronym in Ottawa. And Marta will lead what I expect to be a spirited discussion about population and prosperity. What is the winning mix? Marta.